Yeah, good morning. We're talking today about security issues in mobile devices and networks. First, a word of introduction. My name is Frank Rieger. I'm CTO at GSMK Cryptophone. We are doing encrypted telephones, hardening operating systems for telephones, building voice encryption systems. So looking at the vulnerabilities of mobile phones is basically my daily job. The overview. We are first looking at the security of mobile devices itself, what attack vectors we have, what is the current state of the art in exploiting mobile devices, what is to be expected in the near future. Then we move on to interception methods for voice and data, what is currently being deployed, what is available, what will be available in the near future. Then we talk a bit about location privacy. Basically, why do we need it? What is it? How can we ensure it? Look into the structural problems of mobile networks and move then onto some risk mitigation strategies. Basically, what can you do to solve these problems, or at least not make them bite you as hard as they can? Okay, so the first question is, who of you owns a BlackBerry? Oh, none. One. Okay. Windows Mobile stuff? Around? Oh, none. Symbian phones? Come on. But iPhones. You probably have iPhones. Okay. The question is, why do you trust them? You have to. It's a good answer. Okay. We're looking at, basically, we have our rough outline of a mobile phone. It's a normal smartphone. You have on the lower layer CPU that is running all the applications and the operating system. And we have another CPU that is basically driving all the GSM interfaces or network interfaces to the mobile networks, GSM, 3G, whatever. And this is, in what few people know, this is a separate processor that is running a separate operating system that most of the handset manufacturers have very little access to. And that you also, in most of the cases, have no real influence about as a user. We have quite a number of interfaces. All of them are prone to attack. We start with the first interfaces, the telco networks. Basically, the phone talks to the via GSM or GPRS or 3G to the telecommunications network, which is kind of old-fashioned technology. All the standards that have been implemented there have been mostly specified end of the 80s, mid of 90s, so this is pretty old stuff. And the code that is running on these GSM engines is from the same era. So there are only four GSM stacks around that are running on these, on the GSM module on your phone, and basically everybody is using one of them. And the only larger scale innovation came now with the 3G networks, when basically new chipsets were needed, but still, in all these chipsets running on the GSM side or 3G side of things, there's still code from 1994. So, which is a time in history where secure coding in C was not very well known. So, then, of course, came the internet. You want to talk to the internet via your telecommunications operator, via 3G or via GPRS. So basically, on top of the vulnerabilities that you have in the GSM engine itself, you now have all the nice stuff that is coming down from the internet. Of course, you can directly go to the internet via wireless LAN, which is one of the most overlooked venues of attack against the mobile phone. For instance, on Windows mobile phones, at least up to 2003, we had the case that all the internal sockets that were connected to the GSM engine could be accessed directly as IP ports on the wireless LAN, which was very good for debugging because you could use the ports that were used, for instance, for MMS, for picture messaging, directly over wireless LAN. It was basically a debugging feature that was never switched off and shipped into production code. Another option of attacking is, of course, having your phone as an attack platform. The most common ways of attack is attacking infrared, which is still around in a lot of devices, Bluetooth, which has been quite popular, and of course the wireless LAN. So one of the most often seen attacks in the wild is actually impersonating a hotspot at an airport. That is something that a lot of people seem to do, and most people simply don't care, and they just book into anything that provides them internet. And I know people who have their own 3G modem hooked up to a notebook and sharing that 3G network on the airport for free, and just waiting for people to book in and then go onto their phone or on their notebooks. So the protocols that can be attacked are many. So object exchange is one of the most attacked protocols on mobile phones. All the blue snarf, blue snipe, blue anything attacks are meanwhile too long to list on one page. Essentially, you can say Bluetooth is broken. So it can be decrypted, it can be impersonated. All the things that you want to do to a wireless protocol to hack it can be done to Bluetooth. So IP, of course, as mentioned. Interesting SMS and MMS. Short messages have been around since 1996, approximately. Picture messaging, MMS, since about 7 years, 8 years. And while SMS is relatively straightforward, you have a small defined protocol. MMS is basically a can of worms. What it means is anybody can send you 50K of unchecked, unsigned, unverified binary to your phone and hope that it's being interpreted as a picture or a movie. And one of the things that really break on all phones that we have looked at are the picture and movie viewers, because most often they come from some cheap company in India or Russia or somewhere, and nobody has properly audited them. So what is currently happening in Europe is that MMS Trojans are getting slowly widespread, and they're very, very good because they're not trying to write to the flash memory where they could get caught by the operating system, but they're just memory resident because mobile phones most of the time don't get switched off. They just get to put to standby, and most people don't even switch off their mobile phone at night. So 60% of the population statistics has their mobile phone always on. So maybe they switch it to silent, but they just leave it on, which means that the Trojan in memory can be resident as long as it wants. And what these Trojans are currently doing is just criminal mischief. They're just sending MMS to other people to infect them and then send off a few premium SMS to make money. This is basically an SMS service where you send one SMS to a, let's say, a horoscope service and say, I want a horoscope, and you get one back and costs you $2. And with that, you can actually make money by sending SMS. So if somebody can send money, send SMS on your phone, he can get your money. So same thing with doing premium calls, that is quite attractive to the criminal enterprises. SIM cards. The SIM cards in GSM phones are meant to be like a secure node. So the keys for network encryption, authentication to network are in the SIM card, and actually getting them out of the SIM card is relatively hard. So that is nothing that you can easily do. You can do it if you invest a bit of money, but it's not nothing that you can do in large scale easily, at least not anymore. But there are protocols associated with the SIM card that's, for instance, called SIM Toolkit, which is a very old system that had been designed before all these fancy applications were on mobile phones. And what the operators wanted to do with that is doing information services or reconfiguring your SIM card or reconfiguring your phone, stuff like that. And so SIM Toolkit is sitting there, is implemented on the phones, is implemented on the SIM cards. And what the operator can basically do is executing code on your device without you being even notified. So you probably have seen when you scroll through a modern mobile phone, you have this little check mark, notify SIM activity. So by all means, switch that on, because that is the only thing that is between you and the SIM Toolkit exploit. In that case, the phone will pop up and say, okay, do you want to allow SIM activity? And of course say no, because there's no good reason to do that. You know, the current generation of exploits against the iPhone, one of them was a SIM Toolkit exploit, so I was really happy to see that finally in the wild, because so far most of the people have kept this kind of exploit private, but now it's basically out there. What they did was very fine. They used the AT command interface between the application and operating system to the GSM engine and exploited the SIM Toolkit stack on the GSM engine and got code to run on the GSM engine to patch up the bootloader and do their thing there, which is a very elegant exploit. But the problem is that this can also be done by mischievous people that just don't want to unlock iPhones but do all kinds of harm. The APIs between the operating system and the GSM engine is very specific to what kind of phone you have. So I spent my time mostly on Windows Mobile. The APIs there, one of them is called RIL, the radio interface layer, have evolved over time, but the problem is that they're specific to the handset manufacturer, meaning that the operating system vendor is giving you a skeleton, DLL, that you can fill up with the command specific needed to communicate with the GSM engine. It's more or less the same with all the mobile operating systems. It has just different names there. And these APIs are more or less considered private, meaning that they are just talking between the operating system and the GSM engine. No one is expecting the GSM engine to be hostile. So when you're running on the GSM engine, you have a 95% chance of exploiting the API in the operating system and going forward from the GSM engine to the mobile phone operating system. Most of the time, of course, this would be a waste of time because the operating system is much more vulnerable than anything else on other avenues of attack. But for technical elegance, this is, of course, 10 points. There, as I said, there are a number of services open mostly on the wireless LAN that could be exploited. The most significant security problem that we have on mobile phones is, of course, the user. Because what users tend to do is they tend to install applications and to trust things that they see on their mobile phone screen. And so we say at Cryptophone, okay, once you got code execution on the device, we probably don't need to bother about security anymore because the operating systems on the mobile phones are not as hardened as they used to be in the PC sphere. So most of them have in the last 3 years introduced segmentations and kernel level priority, user land priority, so the very basic security stuff, so memory protection and so on. For instance, on the iPhone, nothing of that is to be found. So the iPhone is running all root. So that means if you can execute anything on that thing, it's yours. So Windows Mobile is a bit better, BlackBerry is a bit better, Symbian is, yeah, I'm coming to that in a moment. So the most significant problem that you always have with mobile phones is the user. So they want to install games mostly, they want to download ringtones. Ringtones is my favorite subject. I have actually a collection of ringtones that you can use to own mobile phones. So basically, you can give a ringtone to someone and own his phone. And most people think, okay, this is a ringtone, how can this own the phone? The problem is, these, as I said, the media parsers in most mobile phones I know are severely broken. So there is really old code in there, and no one has properly audited them because the operating system vendors like Microsoft say, okay, our responsibility ends at the operating system package that we hand over to the handset manufacturer. So if you say, okay, I want to do Windows Mobile handset, you get a deal with Microsoft and you get a package of stuff to build your phone. And of course, they support you, but what third-party applications you add on there, that's your choice. And so that's where the whole thing breaks most of the time. Yeah, that's then what happens. So I have a few totally subjective opinions on platform security. BlackBerry has been one of my favorite subjects because they have been hit pretty hard last year and the year before, and they have learned meanwhile, and they're investing a lot of stuff into security. But still, the system is really huge. So there's a lot of code base, it's a very complicated infrastructure, and there's a lot of attack surface, and I know a couple of guys who are working on BlackBerry still, even while it is a hard target, but it's also a juicy one. So there is certainly a lot of things to do. Okay, fortunately they have the industry base behind them to do that. The problem is that it's such a vital infrastructure for a lot of people. So even in Germany, which is not very densely populated with BlackBerries, you have to. The situation when there's a BlackBerry outage, people are a bit like zombies. Yeah, so like, oh, my email. So what I'm gonna do too this day? So hey, party. Windows Mobile, Microsoft has done a pretty good job in auditing the operating system multiple times through. So they've taken things serious. They've come a long way since Windows Mobile 2003. But still, the problem is the third-party application. So when maybe HTC goes on or some other vendor goes on and does their handset, they put on picture viewers, MMS viewers, MP3 players, video players, picture contacts, also one of my favorite subjects. So there are proprietary protocols to send over an image of you so that it gets inserted as a vCard into the picture contacts at the phone. And so it's been then being inserted. And only when the phone calls, the large image is being shown, which means that this part of the parser is being activated, which means that with a phone call, you can own the phone, which is great. But Microsoft is also very responsive, that I need to say, sir. When we come to them with a problem, they're very fast and very responsive. The only problem is if it's handset specific, they need to say, it's the handset manufacturer, sorry. Symbian, it's very hard to write stuff for Symbian. So normal userland applications that have just a little bit of user interface are still much harder to do than for Java or for Windows Mobile. And the same applies to malware. But the applications are broken as everywhere else. So if you just can be content with running in the application space of the application that you exploit, you have still a lot of fun on the Symbian devices. Yeah, and the iPhone. So my prediction is probably this year they will get a very, very bloody nose in terms of security. One thing common to all mobile smartphone vendors is they have this one chorus that's, but we have code signing. Code signing will save our ass. So because if someone wants to do malicious code, he needs to first get permission from us and get his code signed to run his malicious malware. So and when I talk to these people and tell them, okay, do you know what a disassembler is? And do you know how to search for keys inside a binary and how to exchange these keys in memory? So how hard can it be? And have you heard about that some of your companies are still using MD5 certificates? And so code signing, as you probably all know, is not something that would really save us. Which brings us to the question, what has prevented an outbreak of mobile malware so far? Which is one of the most interesting questions in this presentation. There have been, from the antivirus vendors, a lot of predictions for, okay, there will be severe mobile outbreaks, there will be all kind of mayhem on the mobile phones, and it has not happened so far. There have been a few proof of concept programs out there. There have been localized outbreaks of MMS and similar Trojans, but they have all been contained and never gone massive. The reason is that most of the operators in the Western world do a lot of filtering and profiling and fraud prevention in the networks. So when they see that there is in a certain group of people and sudden rise in MMS activity, these people are sending no MMS at all, and then suddenly say send 70, or they can even do it for group or local or people that have done phone calls to each other and so on. There are a lot of fancy monitoring tools. What they basically do is they're watching most of the avenues of attack. The one thing that they cannot really watch well is, of course, the IP. So if you do IP on your mobile phone, they cannot really help you except with the network structure. So the networks are heavily segmented. Most of them, the Western mobile operators segment you into one class C network when you're on the network, so you're not getting to see any of your neighbors. So if you do a localized exploit, the chances are very low that you see a high enough population of your target operating system, so because it's a very heterogeneous group, so you have four or five major operating system brands on the mobile sphere, plus a number of versions in them, which massively reduces the surface of attack statistically. So if you want to do something, then you need to have a reliable exploit for the platform and develop that. It's a lot of effort. That all changes now with the iPhone. So with a penetration rate nearing 30%, having one single operating system version across the whole of the population, and everybody using the same sync services, everybody using basically the same applications on them, you have a very reliable attack population, or attackable population. So this is the main reason why I think that the iPhone will get a bloody nose this year. Another important issue is that, as I said, with a mobile exploit, you can have a lot of money in your pocket, because you can cause other people's phone to do things that cost these money and earn you money. So there are premium phone numbers, there are premium SMS, there are premium MMS, and all you need to do is sending off one SMS to earn $5. So that is the ratio. So you need to, and if you keep it slow and not overdoing it, you're probably not even hitting the fraud filtering at the mobile operator's side. So they're looking for massive outbreaks, and they're looking for massive anomalies on the billing systems. So people, like I said, there was one case with a Trojan running wild. They quickly contained it. It was in Eastern Europe, because it was sending over 70 MMS per phone. So, which was kind of overdoing it, because these people usually send 1 or 2 MMS per year, if at all. So, these are the main reasons why we haven't seen mobile outbreaks so far, but there's good hope that there will be one this year. Okay, of course, all this kind of problems leads to a market. So there is a huge market, for commercial mobile spyware. So one of the things that you can buy on the internet for relatively moderate prices are pre-modified normal phones. These are not smartphones, but classic phones, so-called spy phone. There are a number of names for this kind of devices. What it basically is, it's a normal Nokia phone with a modified firmware. And what you do is you can control the phone over SMS that are not being shown to the user. So we can use this phone as a room audio bug. So you just switch on the microphone, call into that thing. The phone doesn't ring, it just picks up, it doesn't flash the display, it doesn't show at all that anything bad is going on. The only thing that you will notice when your attacker is overdoing that is that your battery drains more. So, and if you have contracted where you pay incoming calls, then you will also see it on the bill. But in Europe, for instance, most people, no, there is no contract that pays for incoming except on roaming. So there are, I think, 5,000 different models of modified spy phones on the market. You can buy them as cheap as £65, but if you like, you can also pay like €4,000 for them. So it just depends on how far down the spy shop chain you are. So the nearer the manufacturer, the cheaper, of course. You can see them on strange auction sites like Alibaba, where they're being basically openly sold. And it's relatively difficult to defend against getting slipped one of these things. What is also happening, what has been observed at border crossings into less than democratic states, is that the mobile phone firmware got flashed on the border, which means they took your belongings, say, wait a moment, vanished for 10 minutes in some room, and then, okay, it's everything okay, and give you your stuff back. So if this happens, next thing is take your phone, put it in a glass of water, so and get a new phone. So this is something that can be done very quickly. So for most of the popular phone models, there are very small clips that are looking like an oversized headset connector available on the market that you just plug in and quickly reflash the phone. And the more premium models of those first back up all your data from the phone, then reflash the phone and put your data back in. Some of them, the more cheaper ones, don't. So they just reflash your phone and it's like it's coming from the factory with the add-on of that. There are also phones available that have installed a hardware bug, but this is kind of stupid because this is the perfect bug. The user is taking care of it, he's taking it with him, so he's speaking to it, he's feeding it, so power is always there, and he's even paying the bill for it if you need to. Another brand of mobile spyware are smartphone Trojans. There are, as far as I know, currently 6 different smartphone Trojans for sale on the market. This is the feature list of one of the more advanced ones. You can listen to the phone, or you can know where it is. You get all SMSs incoming, outgoing, or you get all email, call history, call durations, contact names and address book. You get notified when there is a SIM change, so when a user changes the SIM, it doesn't bother you, you just get an SMS with the new SIM stuff or a GPRS upload. You can download it all in nice spreadsheet format for watching your spouse or whatever. So there are even web services for that. It's like nice web 2.0, clickety-click. So it's really scary. This is the market leader that works with Symbian, BlackBerry, and Windows Mobile. So for all the phones, all the major devices. And it's indeed relatively hard to find. So we had phones coming in from customers, not our phones, but phones that the customers had before, and they asked, okay, something is fishy about this phone. We know you guys know about mobile phones. Can you take it apart? And it takes indeed a ROM dump and a diff with a known to be good ROM of the same same model to find the Trojan. So they're quite good at hiding it. And if you're not knowing that something is fishy on your phone, you will never notice that it's happening. Okay, device theft is one of the most common criminal acts around. So devices are being stolen like hell. Most of the thieves are going onto BlackBerries and smartphones because they just simply yield more when they sell them off. If you steal a €30 or $30 Nokia phone, prepaid throwaway thingy, then not even your dealer wants to get that because he probably has a crate full of it. So they get onto more expensive phones. And the forensic tools for mobile phones have become quite good. So the commercial forensic tools that you can buy for smartphones are meanwhile idiot safe, so they can hand it to people who have no technical education, and they are able to extract most of the interesting data from the mobile phone. So that means that it is not anymore the case that you need a specialized forensics lab to extract data from mobile phone. They're building suitcases for drug enforcement officers who can do an extraction on the spot. So it's just plug in phone into suitcase by choosing the right cable and push a button and then have all the data on the screen. So these kits are also for sale commercially. So that means you can expect if a device is lost and the data is not encrypted, then the data can be extracted. The only exception is data stored on the SIM when a SIM pin is activated, which most people don't have. But if you activate the SIM pin, then it's getting a bit harder to extract the data from that SIM. And one of the most problematic things that we notice is that people, when their phone is gone, they're not suspecting theft at first. So most people, if they're not noticing that somebody has really taken their phone from them on the street or something like that, they assume that their phone has been stolen. Actually, the ratio, these are British statistics, is 1/3 stolen, 2/3 lost. So, which means if your phone is gone, then there's a 1/3, under normal circumstances, 1/3 it's been stolen, 2/3 it has been lost. If you're a more interesting person, then it probably has been stolen. Okay, so we're leaving now the mobile device security and going on to the network structure. So this is how our mobile network looks like. We have the little green triangles, these are our users. You have the big red dots, these are our cell towers. And the blue blobs are basically the cell areas that are covered by the antennas on the cell tower. So each cell tower has multiple antennas, and each of the antennas covers a section that is roughly ellipsoid. So what happens when your user A down there in the mobile network and user B somewhere else want to talk? So user A tells the network, okay, I want to talk. The cell receives the call and hands it off most often through a microwave connection to another cell tower, because renting cable space in the ground or getting cables laid is much more expensive than just shooting microwave across to another cell tower. So usually you have one cell tower that has cable connectivity to the network and about 10 or 15 other cell towers that are shooting to that cell tower and handing their traffic off there. And from there, it goes over cable to the network operator. It's mostly ISDN or SS7 type. And from there, it goes to the phone network, mostly SS7 or even IP. So that also happens. And from there, we go to the over whatever network is available to user B. So what we have is we have a number of segments that are vulnerable to attack. We're ignoring the cable for the moment because most of that has been explained yesterday by Jim Atkinson. And we're focusing on the wireless stuff and a bit on network structure. So the first link, the white link between the cell tower and the user is becoming one of the most vulnerable links in the whole system. So in GSM, you have basically a basic encryption that's called A5. We come to the details later. But there is some encryption. And if we want to get around that, there has been an invention in, I think, 94 or 93 or something like that, that is called the IMSI catcher. So the basic idea was, okay, police has a suspect. It doesn't know who he is. It doesn't have his phone number. And so it wants to know the phone number, which is the IMSI, IMSI, which is basically the network internal representation of the SIM card's identity. So the network operates by these IMSIs, and the assignment to a telephone number is happening later at the network logic level. So in order to tap someone, you need to go to the operator and telling him either the phone number or the IMSI, and then they can do that. So what they did was they built a system, people at Rohde and Schwarz in Munich, that you see on top there. Normally, you have the user talking directly to the cell tower. So and we have our bad guy down there. What the bad guy now is doing, he's impersonating the cell tower. So this system up there is saying, hey, I'm in cell tower. And I'm having better signal strength than the cell tower that you were previously talking to. And the system is smart enough to look at the network structure around and impersonate the correct cell tower, which is one that is relatively weak from that spot, but is still in the neighbor cell list of the phone. So each phone is keeping a list of cell towers around that they may connect to if the current cell connection is lost. So these are the so-called neighbor cells. What the IMSI catcher does, it impersonates a neighbor cell so that it's all legal and valid. So, and then it impersonates the phone towards the network. So this is what the two mobile phones on top of the thing are good for. They're basically taking over the user credentials and talking to the network and saying, okay, I'm this user's phone, everything is fine. So what we have is a classical man in the middle. So the user's phone is getting intercepted and you're getting out there. This system has a number of drawbacks. One of them, it usually causes network disruption. Because if you're not the only guy around, then you're having problems with other people trying to book into your simulated cell. Then you have the problem that this call is not showing up on the user's phone bill when you're not actually impersonating also the SIM credentials, which is a little bit hard to do. And you're having, if you're not impersonating SIM credentials, then you're also not having incoming calls. So there are solutions for all of that, but they're complicated and sometimes they don't work. And you're causing disturbance and the operators really, really hate you. So because they're seeing errors in the network that are difficult to debug. So nonetheless, this equipment, if you buy it at Rohde & Schwarz, has cost, I think, 150,000 euros, which was the price they sold you for. And I said, hey, you see that equipment in the middle there? So remember it? It is basically a handset test system that is being used to test handsets. And in that case, it was a Rohde & Schwarz CMD55, which can be bought on eBay for roughly 3,000 euros. It's meanwhile, it should be cheaper. What the thing does is it simulates a cell tower for only one channel, and you need to do some configuration work, but it does the thing quite nicely. So all that you need to do now is somehow marry it to a phone that hands off the call to the network and getting the audio out in between. And we did that, I think, 2 years ago. It took us about a week, so we did some modifications to the software of the CMD55, the handset test analyzer, which is a very nice MS-DOS 6 system. So like the good old days. And all you needed to do then is hook up in booster to the antenna output so that you could have higher range. So normally these things are being meant for attaching a very small inductive pad that you place your phone on, but the modification to put on the booster is not really hard. And what you can nicely demonstrate with that is that you're being the network and someone can make a phone call, you can replay the phone call later on. So it's not really difficult. Has, of course, the problems with incoming calls and not being on the bill and so on. So we didn't go into impersonating the SIM card and so on because we know it's possible, at least in some networks. But what the hell? Okay, this was a while ago. What is currently happening is something much more interesting, which is a so-called semi-passive attack. We have the same scenario. What now happens is the bad guy only briefly impersonates the cell tower at connection setup. So basically, he's listening very carefully to the clock of the GSM channel that his victim is on, and is inserting with higher power at the right time and call setup a few frames that switch off the encryption. So, because as I said, there are a number of encryption modes in GSM A5, and there's one that's called A50, which means zero encryption. And then you can listen in. So what then happens is the call is being set up as normal to the cell tower, but with encryption off, and the bad guy can listen in passively. Okay, normal phones have a requirement to show you if the call is encrypted or not. There's a little lock symbol. So if you see a little open lock symbol, in most Nokia phones have it, most Sony Ericsson phones have it, Microsoft has it meanwhile too. They had a bug in there that we showed them. So most phones do that. But your operator has the freedom to deny you that information. It is a writable flag on the SIM card that has some very euphemistic name. It's something like user encryption information flag or so. And if you set that, then the user is not being informed about encryption not being on. And it's also written in GSM standard. And the reason they do that is, yeah, we don't want to confuse the user. I said, okay, what the hell? You want to really deny the user the information if there's encryption on or not? They said, yeah, the problem is, if some GSM network component fails, we need to encrypt, put the encryption off ourselves to ensure service. And so that's then when this little flag doesn't mean anything. Another very nice playground is the microwave links. So microwave links between the cell towers are in 90% of the cases not encrypted. They rely on that the equipment for intercepting microwave stuff has been very expensive, but meanwhile it's being available on a surplus market for relatively cheap. So we cobbled together a system that costs us about $10,000. Using the usual surplus dealers, and we didn't need to do any major software writing. We could basically get anything together. What you have there is basically a representation of an ISDN S2M channel on microwave modulated, and that is relatively easy to intercept. The good thing about microwaves is that the link doesn't end at the receiving point. So if you see this graphic, you see, okay, that the link is between one point, another point. But in reality, you have either side lobes of the antennas, meaning that besides the antenna towers, there's a lot of microwave stuff to be received. And of course, the radio signal doesn't stop at the receiving cell tower. It just goes on up into space, up to the NSA satellites. So, and it's really, that's what they did in the 80s in Russia. So Russia had a microwave network all over the country, and the NSA parked satellites so that they could see off the bounce. what was going on. So, and now we can do that for 10K from ground, just climb up to the roof. The good thing is you're getting everything nicely structured, ISDN compatible without a lot of hassle. So it's easy to do. And there has been a case in, there has been a case in Europe where there was a blackmail attempt onto a general who was negotiating for his country some major armament deal. And of course the little gentleman freaked out and sent out his military intelligence to find out how he could have been tried to blackmail with his phone calls. And what these people found out was that at the airport in this country, somebody was running such a system for 2.5 years now and was just opportunistically listening in, identifying who the person is, and was then randomly blackmailing people successfully for 2.5 years. So, and that's how easy it is. So he basically lived off that thing. Yeah. So it was an unemployed former radio technician who figured it out himself, and yeah. Okay, we talked a bit about the A5 encryption algorithms and what they mean, so we are going into more detail now. Basically, there are four types of algorithms. Only three of them are actual algorithms. A51 is the stuff that's being used in most Western countries, including USA. A52 is being used in France. And in most of the developing countries that either not got sold the proper A51 equipment by their Western hosts who don't want to have so much work with the encryption, or they basically want to listen in themselves. Then we have A53, which is the so-called Kasumi algorithm, which has been developed for the 3G networks, which is a relatively modern algorithm. Some GSM networks are phasing in A53 meanwhile, because they want to issue only one kind of SIM card. And older GSM SIMs don't speak A53, they only speak up to A51. But meanwhile, everything that's called so-called USIM, which is what they issue for 3G and UMTS phones, they speak A53. And then we have A50, which is usual signal when all the networks around you going to A50, then get to the airport fast. So, especially if you're in Russia, so then that has been happened time and again. That in Russia, for instance, in Moscow, when they had trouble of some kind, they switched all the encryption networks off to reduce the workload, simply to be able to tactically intercept on the street without any hassle everything. Okay, FF1 has been broken. The algorithm is broken to a point where you, when you have in, let's say, 2 terabyte of rainbow table and a few FPGAs, you can break them in non-real time, like half an hour, which means if you add more hardware and more rainbow tables, getting much faster. A52 is being broken in a way that you basically can decryption on a notebook in real time, which means it's totally broken. A50, there's nothing to break, it's just clear text. And A53 is probably weak. So there's nothing that where I can say, okay, here's their attack and go on, and there's stuff that can be done. But the cryptographers who have looked at it concluded that it's weaker than it should be for such a system. What you need to understand is the A5 algorithms are the most widely deployed crypto system on Earth. There's actually 1 billion pieces of equipment with these algorithms around. So and replacing them is nearly impossible. So phasing in A53 has been projected to take 20 years over all of the Earth. So, and so that means what they deployed there was crypto that they knew was broken. So the question was, of course, does 3G help? So if I don't want to be intercepted with the methods that we listed, can we switch to UMTS phones? Yes, you can, but 3G can be easily jammed. What you see there is a commercial multiband jammer that jams all the GSM bands plus UMTS and can be switched on selectively. And what then actually happens is the vendors that sell you the GSM intercept equipment and they don't have yet 3G intercept equipment just sell you a 3G jammer with their equipment. What you then just do if you have a victim phoning with 3G is flip on the jammer, he cannot phone anymore, the phone automatically falls back to GSM because all UMTS phones are also GSM phones because UMTS 3G doesn't have nationwide coverage, it's only in the cities. And you can use your GSM equipment as before. So that's what they do. And what you need to know is 3G is only encrypted on the air. After that, it's as vulnerable as all the other telephone stuff, so against interception in the network. Okay, here's some, for illustrative purposes, some of the systems that are currently on the market for passive GSM intercepts. Some of them are semi-passive, basically doing the attack that I've shown, or variants of that, disabling the crypto, then passively intercepting. All of them can do A52 in real time. Some of them can do A51 in near real time or real time. You need a small FPGA cluster for that. And prices are varying between $200,000 or more down to $80,000 for the Romanian system up in the right corner. So everybody and his little brother who worked at the university and an intelligence agency has been spinning off systems like this in Eastern Europe, in Israel, in Russia, everywhere. So if you look hard enough and pay cash, then you can buy such a system off the market. Lots of private investigators have done so, and they're paying off these systems. Okay, what is happening now is the next generation of homegrown passive interception is coming around. Just in this March, my friends from the A5 cracking project showed the first prototype working. It is basically a USRP, which is a software radio, and you need an FPGA to do the decoding work. As I said, approximately 2 terabyte rainbow table, and you're set. Total cost of system, if you buy everything, including the notebook on the market, we're talking in the region of 5,000 euros. So that's what it needs to break GSM starting this summer and passively intercept what is being around. So this will not give you A51 in real time, but with half an hour delay, but A52 and A50 in real time, which means that the threat model has changed completely. That means that everybody who has a software radio, and there are a couple of thousand already sold, and many more will be sold when the software is being released, can do GSM intercept. Another fascinating element of the GSM networks are short messages. There are different information depending on operator if short messages are inside the A5 crypto envelope or not. At some operators, they are not. Sometimes SMS are even sent over GPRS unencrypted. And an SMS is something that is being traveling a lot. So if you, for instance, send an SMS between two operators, it goes through an intermediate center, which is mostly private enterprise, that is running a translation service between all the operators. And since you can send SMS between most GSM networks in the world, you even can send an SMS to Bangladesh and it arrives, actually. Maybe sometimes mangled if you have funny characters in it, but it arrives. And in worst case, there are 7 or 8 translation centers in there, sitting in between there, where your SMS arrives and is being transported through in clear text and is being backupped in databases, is running through analyzers, is being sold. So everything happens to SMS. Another interesting feature of SMS is the so-called type 0 SMS that can be used for SMS ping. You may not know that when you activate receipt acknowledge required in your phone and send an SMS, you're getting a special type of SMS back that says your SMS has arrived at the other phone. So I think T-Mobile is supporting it in the US. I don't know about the other networks. And this kind of SMS can be sent also without an SMS. So you're basically sending an empty SMS that has so-called type zero to a phone, and you're getting back and received acknowledge. And that process is generating in the billing records at the operator a full call data record, including position of the phone. So this method is very very much loved by lawful intercept people and the law enforcement agencies to continuously track people. So they just ping them every hour and get a convenient call data record into their normal law enforcement intercept systems where this guy has been at that point. Also, SMS are very easy to fake. So if you're getting an SMS and you're doubtful about if it's being the real thing, then it's probably not the real thing. So there are a number of ways to fake origins of SMS, so don't trust that. What you see on the right is my chancellor in Germany. She actually governs by SMS, of course, unencrypted. So, and I always wondered why all the embassies in the middle of Berlin have these huge antennas on their roofs. But when I read that story, I knew. Another new development are GSM picosols. Essentially, with the picosol, which is a very small GSM cell, you can build a GSM network in a box. The suitcase that you see down there is a full 16-user GSM network. So that is being actually used for interception purposes. It is very practical because when you have a number of people in an area that you want to intercept and you don't want to play around with these IMSI catchers and man-in-the-middle stuff, you just go there and give them GSM. So there are larger versions of the thing on the right side. They see the satellite dish for backhaul to the network. Actually, these systems have been deployed in Iraq. I've seen one system that's very funny that is in actually air-droppable GSM cell. So, and I asked that guy, okay, so are you dropping that and then? So somebody needs to get that working. I said, yeah, we're dropping also a guy into a motorcycle behind it. And so what basically happens is they drop the GSM cell on the container of fill, and some hero on a motorcycle behind it, he connects the fill line, right, gets on the generator, looks that everything is blinking, hops on the motorcycle, and gets the hell out. And so and then usually something happens in that area. So and so this is actually being used in military and security contexts. For civilian users, these picosols are quite fascinating. They're cheap. They're nice to work with because all the backend network is actually sitting on a Linux laptop. So you're having a nice Linux laptop that is running all the GSM backend components. So that is having your MSC, your HLR, your VLR, and so on. So all the components that you need to run a GSM network are in are very simple VMware compartments on the Linux notebook. They have full control. You can do anything you like. And these picosols are becoming widespread. So the GSM operators are going to deploy these picosols into homes and connect them to your DSL line so that you have better 3G reception at home. So these picosols will become ubiquitous. Another chapter that has been discussed in the US extensively here is the large-scale interception. Or on network level, which is mostly done by intelligence agencies and governments. What is currently state of the art is that in some countries, and it's a growing number, every single phone call and SMS is on file for the last 12 years. Every single. You say, okay, this is a lot of wood, so how do you do that? But if you do the actual calculations, you figure out that in the end, it's about $30 million per year for the whole of Germany. So it's next to nothing to store that stuff. Okay. I want to tell a few stories about what happened actually out there. Yeah, I know I'm late, but I started late because no one was here. So I'm taking my liberty to take 5 minutes longer. Yeah? We had one customer that was a serious crime unit in a small European state that actually figured out that they are being intercepted by the very drug criminals that they were hunting. So they just simply turned the whole game around because the equipment has become extremely cheap. We had another case of where complete C-level, or all the CEOs, CFOs, and so on, of a large multinational, they had been professionally slipped Trojans for their Symbian phones. So it was, they were completely naked. So we had one morning I came to work. There was a guy sitting. He said, "Okay, he flew in straight from a large financial city, and he's a mergers and acquisitions banker, and he has found out that a lot of his transactions are being preempted on the stock market. Somebody is obviously knowing what he's doing." And later on, they found out that they actually had someone sitting on a microwave link to the cell tower at their offices, and they, of course, were on their mobile phones all the time. And my favorite thing, we are selling encrypted phones, so we're having a good overview of who is really threatened by interception. And one of the largest groups was the European scrap metal industry, because when the steel prices went through the roof, they were really cutthroat competing for every old ship around, and so they were really doing shit to each other and trying to get their deals. Okay, on the iPhone you have this very small thing down in the corner at the map, which is the locate me icon, which means not you only know where you are, but also everybody else knows where you are. These locate me services are running by Cell ID, wireless LAN, RFID, barcoders, there are a number of things on that, and they're all network-based. GPS is there, the 9/11 mandate, stuff of them as pings. You can also on SS7 do region requests, basically requesting where a phone is in what region, and you have triangulation. So there are a number of things that you can do with the location when you know what the location is associated with, so you can see if somebody is going to the bankers, is talking to many VCs, is talking to a lobbying firm, was at the competitor's human resources department, has a slight red light district habit, or some other very discreet hobbies, or needs to visit a doctor afterwards. So there's a lot of things that you actually can know from locations. Okay, I want to talk a bit more about SS7, but I'm skipping through that. Essentially, the basic message is on SS7, which is the basic backbone of the telecom systems, they trust you when you pay the money to access. So, and they're doing a bit of filtering, but it's not a lot, and you can do lots of scary things on SS7. And the same applies to the next generation networks that are IP-based. They're basically merging the worth of both worlds, IP and SS7. Okay, so how to protect yourself? You can do it, of course, like the Taliban in Afghanistan. Not recommended. They blew up cell towers because they didn't like all the side effects of cell phones. There was a guy somewhere in the US who drove around in a tank and took down, I think, 7 cell sites because he felt threatened by the waves. Then we have the three-letter agencies that don't allow you to get your phones inside the secure areas, which is a very wise thing. The main thing is you need to know whom you're playing against. Private parties are getting really powerful. I told you $5,000 this summer, full GSM intercept. The legal interception powers are becoming really widespread and they become abusable. The people operating that stuff are subject to bribery or blackmail. Amateurs getting into, and of course, the fraud problem. So what can you do? First rule, encrypt wherever possible. When you have email encryption, switch it on. If you have VPN, switch it on. If you can have storage encryption for your phone, switch it on. Uninstall all the unnecessary stuff, all the blinking, video viewing, MMS. Nobody needs that really, contact picture stuff. So just uninstall it or misconfigure the application so that it cannot be abused. So having no working MMS configuration on your phone is one of the best protections against MMS trojans around. If you can reflash your phone regularly, meaning back up your data, get a fresh firmware from the manufacturer, reflash your phone, because it gets rid of everything that has been done to the phone meanwhile. You can do enterprise device management like stun and kill and software installation and so on, but you look at the solution very carefully. Who is actually managing the phone? Are you it or somebody else? when you're having meetings that, or when you're accessing the network in your company, treat them as suspicious as it's a foreign laptop or something that is coming from an internet cafe. As I said, code signing is no good. In high-risk situations, meaning when you're into a merger, a company is being taken over, stuff like that, leave the mobiles out of the room, period. No exceptions. Not even if it's something urgent, leave it out of the room, leave it with the secretary, she can take the calls. That's not a problem. So intelligence agencies are doing it since years and they have a reason for that. Look at your phone, know if it can be switched, sir. If somebody can slip you another phone, scratch it, have a laser engravement, do something to that. Configure it a bit widely so that it's difficult to swap you a different phone. If it's really hot, get cheap prepaid phones. Send a secretary out to buy a bunch of cheap prepaid phones not associated with your company or your name. Use them only between these phones and throw them away or give them to homeless people. So, which is one of the most smart things to do with these phones. And switch the phone and the SIM because the phones can also be identified. They have a hardware identification number that can be seen in the network. Whenever the phone has been outside of your immediate control, it has been considered compromised. There's no rule, no exception to that rule. When it has been laying around somewhere, if you found it back, or you left it in a taxi and get it back, sir, back up the data, get a new phone. So, otherwise, you need to assume that somebody is onto you. Okay, that was it. Thank you very much. If you have questions, later on. We probably don't have time for questions, right? Yeah, okay, so I'm outside for questions then.